All right, welcome back to Close Up, everyone. Religious liberty has been a cornerstone of his message since well before he actually became a candidate for president. So you can bet that Louisiana Governor Bobby Jindal had a strong opinion with the recent Supreme Court ruling when it came to same-sex marriage and Obamacare. A lot to get through this morning. Governor, good to see you this morning.
Josh, thank you for having me back.
So, I mean, perhaps more than anybody else in the GOP field, you were pretty hot when that ruling came down from the Supreme Court. I think you called them out of control and nothing but a public opinion poll.
Well, look, both of these rulings. So first, in saving Obamacare, Scalia said words no longer have meanings. They're not reading a dictionary. This is the second time they've rewritten the law to save Obamacare. Here's the bigger point, though, about Obamacare. Even though the court has ruled this one part of it constitutional, it is still a bad law that needs to go. It is still a law that is encouraging dependence, creating a new entitlement program when we can't afford the ones we've got, putting millions of Americans into an outdated Medicaid program, and even worse, the president said it was going to reduce health care costs. It hasn't done that. Premiums have gone up, not down. I'm the only candidate with a specific plan to repeal and replace all of Obamacare. I wish the Republicans in D.C. would stop just talking about repeal, offer their own plan, offer their own alternative. Let's show the American people we can actually lower costs. Senator Obama, when he was a candidate, opposed the individual mandate. He opposed the Cadillac tax. Both of those were on Obamacare. He was right when he talked about decreasing premiums. He was wrong in his law.
And most people do agree that the Affordable Care Act provision is still a fight that's far from over. But when it comes to same-sex marriage, you believe in traditional marriage, as do a lot of members of this field. But do you consider it now a settled issue with the Supreme Court ruling?
I don't. Two things. I gave a speech at the Reagan Library over a year and a half ago talking about the assault on religious liberty. It's no longer upcoming. It is here. I still believe that marriage is between a man and a woman. But now what the left is doing is they're going after our First Amendment rights. And what do I mean by that? I think it is wrong for the government to discriminate against, to sanction individuals because of their sincerely held religious beliefs. I did an executive order in May protecting the people of Louisiana, individuals and businesses from that kind of discrimination. The ACLU then turned around and sued me just this last week for that executive order. I know there may be folks that may disagree with me on the traditional view of marriage. I would hope we would all agree that in America, whatever your beliefs, you should have the right to follow your conscience, follow your beliefs if you're not hurting somebody else. And in this case, I think you see an assault from the left to try to take God out of the public square. I hope we can all as Americans agree that our religious freedom rights, the right to follow one's conscience, is extremely important. You can have religious freedom without discrimination. And one more thing I'd add in this debate, I think tone matters. Look, our Republican nominee is likely to be pro-life and for traditional marriage. Every candidate so far has taken those views. I think how we treat people who disagree with us is very important. I think we're all created equally in God's eyes. I also think we're called to treat folks with love and respect the way we want to be treated. No viewer, no voter is going to agree with the candidate 100% of the time, but I do think it's important that we can find those agreements, and where we disagree, disagree respectfully.
And when it comes to the Supreme Court, varying degrees of opinion and reaction to these rulings, let's talk about a Jindal presidency. What do you do about it?
I'd like to see presidents appoint justices who actually read the Constitution. And the reason I made the crack about the public opinion polls is you had the Chief Justice saying, well, they're not following the Constitution. That's their job. If they want to follow public opinion polls or write laws, they should run for Congress. I don't like it when they cite international precedents. I don't like it when they cite national consensus. Their job is to read the Constitution. It's a very important role. Our founding fathers had a checks and balances system in mind. I don't like it when they start doing the job of the Congress, or one of the other two elected branches of government, the White House and the Congress. You look at Obamacare, they're basically, look at the first case. Neither the plaintiffs nor the defendants argued the individual mandate was a tax, yet Chief Justice Roberts called it a tax to save the law, something that neither side was claiming in court, yet they went out of their way to rewrite the text to try to save a bad law.
So let's talk about tone, because you struck a harsh one when it came to President Obama recently when you kind of gave an update on the situation involving ISIS. You called him the most clueless president of your lifetime when he said that the way to defeat ISIS is to win their hearts and minds.
Josh, look, he said we're not going to win this fight through guns. Imagine if Generals Patton and Eisenhower had said that in World War II. The French would be speaking German right now if they believed that. We've got to hunt down and kill the radical Islamic terrorists that are called ISIS. The reality is, this is a president who's now saying it's a generational battle. This went from being the JV team to then he said he didn't have a strategy to defeat them. Now it's going to take a generation. Now he's saying we're not going to beat them with guns. Now he's saying we have to change their ideas. We've got to kill them and their ideas. Now, the reality is we need a fight to win. I wish when he'd gone to the Pentagon, I wished he had said to his military advisors and leaders, I'm taking the political handcuffs off. I want a plan for victory. You know, he refuses to say the words radical Islamic terrorist. He wages war against trans fat. I jokingly said, look, I'll protect my kids from Oreo cookies and microwave popcorn if he'll do his job as commander-in-chief and fight radical Islamic terrorists. Then he apologizes for America. He goes around warning us about medieval Christians and the Crusades. Forget the political correctness. Call them what they are, radical Islamic terrorists. Say we're going to hunt them down and kill them. Give the military the support, the tools they need to win this war. For example, support and arm the Kurds. They've been very successful in Kobani and other areas. Let's show our Sunni allies we're in this to win this. When they drew that red line in the sand and then didn't follow through with Assad, many of our Sunni allies said, why were we going to fight ISIS to help prop up Assad in Iran? And third, he goes to the Congress and says, give me a 3-year deadline. Give me a ban on ground troops. He's the only commander-in-chief who tells our enemy what we won't do instead of what we will do.
Let's talk about the Iran deal, nuclear deal. I don't want to have your answer expire because we're taping this in the middle of the week. So we'll see what happens. But what do you believe should or can't be part of this deal?
This is what I think a good deal looks like. And I worry they want a bad deal, and I think a bad deal is worse than no deal. I think a good deal means that Iran has to accept the right of Israel to exist. I think they have to cut off any ties to terrorist groups like Hamas, Hezbollah, and other groups. Third, they have to give up all their enriched uranium. Fourth, they have to give up their uranium centrifuges, their enrichment capacity. Fifth, they have to cut off a pathway to a plutonium bomb. Sixth, they have to have anytime, anywhere inspections, including military sites. And then finally, seventh, sanctions should only be lifted gradually, not all at once, so that we can verify they're actually complying with these requirements. They should also, by the way, release those American prisoners. It's amazing to me, we're negotiating with the regime, holding American prisoners, chanting death to America, death to Israel, and we're talking about allowing them to become a nuclear power. Josh, we could be starting a nuclear arms race in the Middle East. The Egyptians, the Saudis, and Turkey, these Sunni countries, I believe, will go and try to buy a nuclear capability from Pakistan. Talk about the danger of Armageddon. Here's the problem. This president said in the beginning that they were going to get rid of their enrichment capacity. He said they weren't going to keep their enriched uranium. Now he's talking about allowing them to have thousands of centrifuges, nuclear R&D capabilities. The Iranians are saying you won't get inspections on military sites. A bad deal is worse than no deal. I think this is one of the reasons the Israeli leadership, Netanyahu and others, are very concerned. And it's not just Republicans in Congress. There are Democrats in Congress very concerned about the path that this administration seems to be on. I wish he was as hard on the Iranians as he seems to be on Congress. He seems to be pushing back on Democrats and Republicans who want to slow down this bad deal.
All right, time's flying, so let's bring it back home and talk about, well, one candidate has kind of become an issue unto himself, and that's Donald Trump with his comments about immigration. First, what did you think about what he had to say? Because there's varying degrees.
I disagree with his comments. Josh, look, I look as people, as members, as individuals, not members of ethnic groups or economic groups. I do think we need to secure the border. I don't think that needs to be done as part of a comprehensive bill. I don't agree with amnesty. I think this president broke the law, broke the Constitution in doing that. I also think that we don't put enough emphasis on assimilation, on integration. I think that people who want to come here should want to be Americans, should learn English, should adopt our values, come legally, roll up their sleeves, and go to work. I'm tired of the hyphenated Americans. We're not Indian Americans or African Americans or rich Americans or poor Americans. We're all Americans. We used to proudly call America the melting pot. What worries me is in Europe, you've got second, third generation immigrants that don't consider themselves part of that culture. We must not allow that to happen here. Too many on the left think that we should be a salad bowl, not a melting pot. I think that's a mistake. And finally, I don't think we should give freedom to anybody who wants to use that freedom to undermine freedoms for other people.
And we are almost out of time, but I just want to get your take on this. Greece, does America have a role to play here, or is this up to the Eurozone?
Well, look, this will be up to the Eurozone, the EU. I will say this. Greece could be our future if we're not careful. Look, they have too high taxes, a very bad regulatory state. They've got a slow-growing private sector economy. They're spending beyond their means. They've got pension systems that are not funded. Sounds a lot like us. And the reality is that Hillary Clinton, President Obama are taking us down the path to socialism. I give Bernie Sanders credit. At least he's being honest about it. At least he calls himself a socialist. We've got to rescue the American dream from becoming the European nightmare. Greece, Puerto Rico, that could be our future if we're not careful. Now, look, Greece is an important NATO ally. I don't want them to go into the Russian orbit. But there's no role for U.S. taxpayer dollars, no role for a U.S. government-led bailout. This is between the EU and Greece.
So this is the European Union, and as far as the money is concerned, the U.S. has no role whatsoever.
Absolutely. Look, the IMF and others have already given them a lot of money. This is between the EU and Greece. I think what we can learn from Greece, they gave us democracy. Now they're showing us how to kill democracy. Let's not follow their example.
A lot of governors in this race, wide open field. Polling doesn't mean a whole lot right now, even though we keep putting them on the air anyway. But what do you point to make yourself separate from some of the other governors, for instance?
Well, a couple of things. One, I'm saying let's embrace our principles. Jeb Bush says let's lose the primary in order to win the general. I say that's ridiculous. I think we need to be a conservative party, stop trying to get the left and the media to like us. We got to repeal Obamacare, secure our borders, grow the private sector economy, not the government economy. We've got to reinvest in our national defense, stand with Israel, stop Iran from becoming a nuclear power. Secondly, I'm a doer, not a talker. There are a lot of folks that talk a good game. We've cut our budget 26% in Louisiana. We've cut over 30,000 state government jobs. We're a top 10 state for private sector job creation. We've got 8 credit upgrades, statewide school choice. We privatized our charity hospital system. I will do and say the things you're not allowed to do and say. There are too many in D.C., including Republicans, say you can't do term limits, you can't balance a budget, you can't shrink the federal budget. We've got to do that. Josh, it's not slowing the growth rate. We've got to shrink the budget. We can either measure prosperity in the government or the real world. We measure prosperity in the real world.
All right. Well, best of luck to you moving forward. Going to see a lot of you in New Hampshire?
Absolutely. We're doing several town halls this week, and we'll be back soon.
All right. Good luck to you. Thanks, Governor. Good to see you.